I have the pleasure of being joined today by Hank Rouda, who is at H&M. Thank you for joining me, Hank.
Thanks for having us.
Appreciate it. So when H&M is looking for a lease in real estate, what are they looking for? What sets apart H&M from other retailers?
Well, that's a couple questions. What sets us apart is, well, we'd like to think we're a little bit better than everybody else. But you know, it's going to sound trite, location. But when we're talking about location, you know, it really is going to depend on what type of real estate are we looking for. You know, in New York, it's one thing. In LA, it's something different. In Chicago, it's something different. And in Des Moines, something completely different. You know, the great thing about H&M is that we're scalable, and that we've realized that our mass market reach here in the US, Europe, Asia, enables us to really hit our customers wherever they are. So what we're looking for is the people first, and how do you get the people to what your location is? So we're talking about New York, so let's think about New York. You know, what makes a location attractive in New York? Well, transportation. So look at some of the locations that we have in New York, Times Square. I mean, does it get any better for transportation? Next Wednesday, we're going to open the largest H&M in the world on Herald Square. And, you know, Herald Square, are there better transportation centers in the country than at Herald Square? And then look over at Fifth Avenue. Fifth Avenue, while the transportation itself is different, Fifth Avenue has its own just critical mass that overcomes some of the deficiencies that you might otherwise have with not having a super subway hub right there.
It's interesting, you mentioned Fifth Avenue. And before H&M went to Fifth Avenue, Fifth Avenue looked very different. And I will tell you, every CEO I've talked to about Fifth Avenue at many of the retailers all tell me that it's impossible to make money. But I actually think you guys found the trick.
Well, we did. Fifth Avenue has a special place in our hearts. It was store 001. It's the first location in the country for H&M. And it's a street that really started us in this country 15 years ago. And when we realized that it was time to be able to expand, which we couldn't do in our current location, we found a great location a little bit further down the street. But the one thing that we made sure we could do was make money. And it, you know, people say it's impossible to make money on Fifth Avenue. It's not. But you have to hold to your core values. You have to get the rental structure right. You have to wait for the right location, which is what we were willing to do. And when that location presented itself, we jumped, and we jumped fast. In fact, you can ask my wife how enjoyable the end of our vacation was when I found out that I had a week to negotiate our new flagship on Fifth Avenue. But we got it done because we identified it, and we did it.
That's great. So one of the things that many of my clients are dealing with is the onslaught of the online and the data, really trying to target the consumer a little better than they have, and using things like omni-channeling, where somebody would actually walk in the store would pick up the fact that their customer came in and, you know, hopefully serve up the buying habits and maybe even serve them with coupons and the like. I know that Nordstrom's is doing that here in Herald Square, or not Herald Square, but Macy's is, right, is doing it as well. Is this something that you guys have been considering?
Well, we are looking at different ways to make sure that we can integrate the online experience with the retail experience. You know, we still firmly believe that retailing, especially apparel retailing, is a tactile experience. It's a social experience. People don't want to simply do all of their shopping online. So, you know, we've all been around, we've heard that the catalog was going to kill the mall. Then online was going to kill the mall. Well, the mall's not dead. Shopping's not dead. And, you know, I don't believe that it's going to go away anytime in our lifetimes. But what it's going to do is it is going to transform. And what we're seeing is the shoppers looking and pre-shopping. I know in your interview last year with the president of Lacoste, he talked about the fact that retail, that shoppers are going out looking for their product, knowing what they want, and coming in a much more educated consumer. That's great for us. We want that because we firmly believe that once they come into the store, our price point, in our fashion sense, will get them to go from the three products they were thinking about getting to the 5 to 7. That's going to benefit everybody, the landlord, it's going to benefit us. And so we firmly believe that coming into a market with both our online and our store locations will benefit us.
So what do you see as the biggest opportunities for growth for you guys?
Well, the H&M brand still has a lot to go. We are one of the few people out there doing 25,000 square foot deals, and we're doing them, and we're doing them across all segments of real estate. We're doing them in the outlets, but we do our full price brand in an outlet. We don't like to discount it. We believe that our price point is correct. So we're doing a lot of outlets, but we're also doing Class A centers. So we are very opportunistic. There's still quite a few Class A centers out there that we haven't reached, and we will. So the expansion is coming in H&M. We're not in all 50 states, but that'll happen. Right now, the U.S. is the second largest market for H&M in the world. Germany's number one. That's going to change later this year or next year. We'll be the largest market for H&M in the world, and we're hoping that China's going to let us have the title for about a year before they just blow by us and they take it.
So what do you see as the biggest challenges? Is it the legal frontier, the landscape?
Well, as a general counsel, I'm going to answer that yes. My business people might disagree, although, you know, one of the challenges for a European company coming to the U.S. is understanding the regulatory environment here in the U.S. and how dramatically different it is from most of the other markets that we're in. When I talk to my colleagues in Europe, I try to get them to understand that if you compare the United States to a country like Germany or Sweden, you're missing the boat. Instead, compare the United States to all of Europe. And the dramatic differences that you'll get across Europe is what you see in the United States as well.
So tell me about your sustainability report. I mean, I know you guys are very proud of that.
We are. It's really one of the things that I love about H&M is that we have a set of values that we believe in and that we live. And that carries through to the way we do business, both what you can see and in things that you don't see that are in our supply chain. We are one of the biggest supporters of the CSR movement. We were one of the first companies to sign the Bangladesh Accords. We have clean water initiatives in India. We teach reading to women in India. We believe that it is part of our DNA to give back to the communities that we affect. And it's not just we affect on the front end of the shopping experience, but on the back end, the people that make the clothes. And there's a lot of talk about the fast fashion category and whether it can be ethical. And we believe that it can be if it's part of your DNA and it's part of what you do every day. And each one of us at H&M, part of our goals is a conscious goal. And every single person in the company has a goal to find something that they can do to improve the world.
Great. Well, thank you for joining us today.